This is the television studio where author Frank Waters and Dr. John Milton, chairman of the English Department, University of South Dakota, will join in conversation as KUSD-TV presents Who Reads the Mountains?
Activities of the penitentes are completely taboo now.
Well, up until a few years ago, the penitentes were outlawed by the church. Although originally the penitentes originated in Italy as the Third Order of St. Francis and were taken from Italy to Spain and brought from Spain to Mexico and then from Mexico up to the United States.
Were they brought or were they chased?
It was all legal to start with. Mm-hmm. And then these people in New Mexico and the remote villages throughout New Mexico adopted the order of penitentes. Mm-hmm. And about the same time it was outlawed by the Mother Church. But the people have been left without priests for a long time, so they carried it on themselves. Then when the church came in, the church outlawed the penitenti order. So any member of the church was excommunicated if he was found to be a penitenti.
I see.
I remember going swimming with boys, and they would never take off their shirts when they'd go swimming, because that would reveal the scars of the lashes on the back, would show they were a penitenti. But in the last few years, with all the new highways coming through, the church just overlooks the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
But Taos and Mora were the headquarters of the penitenti sect in the 30s.
I see. Did the civil government object to any of this, as well as the church?
No, the civil government apparently didn't.
Touch them.
But crucifixion was always carried on secretly up a mountain canyon, and guards were posted so that no one could observe them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, this little town of Trampas that we went through.
Yes.
Is there anything going on there now?
I imagine that they have penitentes marauders up the mountain canyons.
But no one hears much about them.
No, uh-huh. No.
Onesimo, the husband, without marriage by the church, of Maria in People of the Valley, undergoing this experience, happens, I think by accident, you suggested, to actually die from the crucifixion. But this was not the intent. That is, they wanted, except for the whippings, they wanted this to be symbolic rather than
it was a symbolic thing. And the trouble is, they were they had to carry this huge cross up a mountain canyon several miles, sometimes through deep snow, so it was overtaxing their strength, and then being bound on a cross. It was a very trying experience, and quite often they would die before they could take them down.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't too unusual for a man to die.
No, and this didn't stop them, however.
No.
Kept right on.
Yeah.
Now, also in People of the Valley, Maria, as a kind of advisor to the people, reads goat skulls. Is this a genuine superstition that came out of this valley again? And would that be Spanish rather than Indian? Or do you recall where you picked up the astrologic readings of goat skulls?
Well, it apparently was an old art that's been practiced all over this continent. And I'll tell you where you can find some more about it in Frank Dobie. Frank mm-hmm. Dobie mentions it in several passages mm-hmm. of these old people being able to read from weather and portents, omens from skulls.
So probably goat skulls simply because they had a lot of goats in
yes,
the dry areas.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Do any of these superstitions remain in the Mora area across the highway again.
When I was over there, in the 30s, they certainly did. But whether they do now or not, I don't know.
Now, in Taos, of course, we know that this has become a kind of tourist town, many months of the year at least. But right outside in the Pueblo, which has been the basis now for your novel, The Man Who Killed the Deer, one at least has the feeling that some of the customs and traditions have been maintained quite carefully. How did you get well enough acquainted, let's say, with the Pueblo Indians to get material for that novel? In fact, you live not far from them now.
Well, after living there for 20 or 25 years and knowing most of those people, you gradually soak in quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
You can't ask an Indian a question about his ceremony because it's secretive and they don't answer, but if you know them, they'll tell you something, and then somebody will tell you something else, and by putting the two together, you can arrive at something else.
Has this happened largely because you've been, say, a friend rather than purely a writer? What about a professional writer coming into the Pueblo? Would he get as much time?
Oh, I don't think if you went out with the notebook in hand and asked questions, you would ever get an answer to a question. Because most ethnologists and anthropologists that go to make studies select certain people they call informants. And they call them over and pay them so much an hour. But you can never be sure of the stuff they tell you. They lie about half the time. But being told a little by little over a long period of years why you can be sure that the information is correct.
Yeah. We met a man named Frank there a year or two ago who lived on the south side of the stream. Do you happen to know him?
Well, I have a very dear friend of 25 years, Frank Zamora. And he, as a matter of fact, he was arrested for killing a deer out of season. That was the incident that starts The Man Who Killed the Deer. I did not know Frank at the time. I just happened to be in the courthouse when this trial came up, and it gave me the idea for the book. But a few years later, I happened to get acquainted with Frank, and he has worked for me and been a friend for many years. He comes up to the ranch, he's always shooed the horses, done chores, and helped us with building. But in the 20 years I've known him, we have never discussed this incident or the book. I'm sure he knows about it.
Yeah, he must.
We just don't talk about it.
Yeah. Now, this is the Frank who was there last summer, I think.
I think you met him,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, we talked to him.
He was there, yes. Uh-huh. He's a very fine man, but like most of the older Indians, they don't like to talk about these things.
No.
Well, we just don't talk. Mm-hmm.
Then you obviously got none of the material from him.
No, I got none of that.
Started simply with the court records.
It was
records.
Before I had met Frank.
Mm-hmm. What year did that incident occur, do you recall? This is late 30s, too, or?
I'd say in the late 30s. 38 or 39, something like that.
Now, the particular problem which you dealt with in that novel, could that still happen now? Or was this... Well, that's only, 20, 25 years ago.
Well,
is that far enough back to make it different?
The background problem of the book is the fight of the Taos Indians for their sacred area in the mountains around Blue Lake. And this thing came up before Congress, and Congress granted the Indians an 80-year lease for religious purposes on this land around Blue Lake, high in the mountains, where they hold their secret ceremonies. Well, in the last 5 years, tourists have gone into the area by pack trips, and dirtied up the lake and so on. So the Indians now would like to get a clear title. So they are instituting a claim for it in the courts. Mm-hmm. And of course that has started the whole controversy over again, because the people of Taos and several newspapers are claiming that these Indians are trying to grab the watershed and usurp all the public land they can get their hands on, although it was legally theirs to begin with. So it started the whole controversy to raging.
Mm-hmm.
And what the status is, I don't know, but I believe that it's up before the Court of Claims, and it's such a hot potato, I imagine it'll be shelved and not settled right away.
I see. Now, if they get Blue Lake, then they would presumably get a wide strip coming down alongside the Taos Stream also.
Many thousands
all the
of
way
acres
down, yes.
up there.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Now, the Forest Service reserved the right to patrol that area in case of fire and to stop overgrazing,
mm-hmm.
which would make a water flood hazard.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, they shut it all off from tourists that went there with pack animals.
Mm-hmm. Well, what is the authority on the Pueblo today? They have their own, quite separate from the federal government authority in town?
Well,
or is this mixed together now?
No, the Pueblo and their reservation and all the people have their own self-government. They have a governor and a council, which is elected, mm-hmm. so they make their own local mm-hmm. laws. And that was given them, that privilege was given them by President Lincoln. He gave every governor a little gold-handled cane, which signified their right for local jurisdiction over their own affairs. So the old governor, on all state occasions, wrapped in his blanket, carries this Lincoln cane as a scepter, mark of his office. But at the same time, the government exercises national supervision.
I see. Now they have a war
through the Indian Bureau.
Yeah, they have a war chief too, don't they?
Yes,
under the governor.
A fiscal who tends to affairs dealings with the Spanish curate, the priest, and the war chief is the outside chief. He deals with affairs outside the council, outside the Pueblo. And they have the old cacique who is elected for life, and he tends to all the religious matters, and the governor tends to all secular matters.
The war chief runs their farms then? Is this true? They do some farming off the
Well, it means cleaning out the ditch. See, it's all communal, so every grown man has to devote several days free work cleaning out the ditches and doing communal duties.
They, I know, maintain rather strong prejudice still against plumbing and electric lights and what have you in the Pueblos.
Well, yes, there's a schism as amongst them as there is us, the liberals and the traditionalists.
Mm-hmm.
The younger men have been away to the army, had their hair cut, come home, and they want good plumbing, electricity, running water, all conveniences. But the older men will not let telephones and electricity in.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the battle between the old men and the young men.
Yeah, and this is likely to change when the young men become older?
That's right. The older men are dying out slowly.
Mm-hmm.
It won't be too long before it'll be modernized, I'm sure.
Now, is it true that the older people in each family live on the ground floor in the Pueblo, and they put the young ones up on the fourth and fifth stories?
No,
climb the ladders?
I doubt if that's true, because more and more families are building little summer houses away from the Pueblo.
Toward the mountains?
Yes, all around. So they live in these little summer homes out in the land alone. except during the winter, and then they have to come in and live in their little cramped apartment in the pueblo.
How strong is the use of the kiva yet?
It's still being used.
Yeah, recently we were kept from going around behind where I had been several times before.
Now, that's
because something was going on.
That's off limits.
Does this practice run down through the young people then too?
Yes,
the old use of the kiva?
Yes, the kiva's called.
Now, how much experience have you had with the kiva practices? Have they ever allowed you into one of those?
Well, that's something I'd rather not get into.
Yeah, okay. If you had, you shouldn't.
Yeah. Yeah.
You shouldn't go beyond them anyhow. Now, with Martiniano in The Man Who Killed the Deer, there is a sense of justice that works two ways. First, you have the Indian against the white man's court, but also within the pueblo itself, there is mixed feeling about Martiniano.
Mm-hmm.
On what basis is this best explained?
I think Martiniano could be looked at now as a young GI just back. He does not want to conform to pueblo custom. And of course, the old men are hell-bent to make him conform.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, a back-to-the-blanket Indian. A young boy that's been to Germany, Korea, or Europe,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
He wants something else.
Yeah, he has simply lost some of the old traditions.
Yeah.
And because of the age differences, the people in the pueblo would be split in their attitudes
yeah.
toward him.
Mm-hmm.
The old trader in that novel, does he come from anyone that you had met?
Yes, he was a very famous, old, wonderful man, just a wonderful man. And if you've been to Taos, you probably know that big building where Frenchie's restaurant is.
Yes.
And the bookstore
mm-hmm.
as the other part. Well, that was Ralph's home.
I see.
And the big dining room of Frenchie's was Ralph's private dining room. And the bookstore, as the bookshop, was his Indian trading
mm-hmm.
post. And the kitchen and the bar now was where he had his Indian craftsmen.
Mm-hmm.
And he was an old, old type of a trader, very profane old man, a lovable man. But he didn't care about selling knickknacks to tourists, 50 cents or a dollar. He was interested in going out, as he had for 40 years, and collecting the finest things. Fine beaded buckskins, fine silver, and selling them to museums like the High Indian Museum Foundation in New York
mm-hmm.
for private collectors for many thousands. And it used to annoy him when tourists would come in and mm-hmm. want to spend a dollar. He would curse at them and run them out in a minute. But a wonderful old man.
He was one of these who had a genuine love then for the
yes.
artifacts, the materials of the land.
He had been a trader all his life. He had been all over and knew them very well.
Do you have any idea where he came from? It's always striking to the person who first or even the second or third times visits Taos to see the mixture of people. Of course, it's a trilingual
well,
community.
I don't know where he came from. His name was Ralph Myers, but he was, I believe, had a German background and evidently one of the old German traders. Taos in the early days had a lot of Frenchmen there, like Ceron St. Vrain, so on. They also had some fine old German families, the Schuricks and so on. So he probably showed up there.
Mm-hmm.
Those early German and French traders.
Yeah, I've seen all these German names in the
yeah.
cemetery there. The Indians still, of course, come into town quite often with their blankets wrapped
mm-hmm.
around them. I got a little disgusted one time, and I forget his name now, the fellow has the motel at the south end of town and runs the little Indian dances at night.
Oh, Jack Denver.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who seems to be exploiting them. Do you have any idea now what the attitude of the Pueblo Indians is toward that kind of thing?
Oh, they just dress up in their fancy duds, the feathers, the sun wheel, and the war bonnet, you know, and probably get a dollar or so a piece for dancing in half an hour. Just straight.
They're just in it for the money. Mm-hmm. Can you think of one characteristic more than any other? This is a problem that has worried me in confronting some of the Pueblo down there. A characteristic in a visitor which would allow him to get close to the Indians. In other words, what do they like in people?
Oh, I think people are the same the world over. If you have a sense of what they call simpatico, if you express or they feel sympathy in you, simpatico, just friendly and don't ask too many questions, I think you could make friends there very nicely. But it's the questions that arouse their antagonism.
Yeah, you've written in several places, in and among your six novels, of incidents of white men. I think Ona's husband, what is his name? Jonathan Cable, who goes out to visit them, simply sits by the fire.
Yeah.
Makes no overtures and mm-hmm. just waits until... Mm-hmm. This is the attitude that you're describing,
simply
to mix in with them. Mm-hmm. Do you still go over to the Pueblo?
Yes, I have a lot of friends. Go out there quite often. I like the feeling about it. It's nice.
Mm-hmm. Now, you say you've never discussed with Martiniano and his other name that incident. Have any of these people talked to you about your books? Do they hear about them at all, or is this something out of their context altogether?
Well, when I wrote the book, I was afraid that every friend of mine would be punished severely for having told me information, because they had a wonderful, wonderful ethnologist that had come out and made a study of Taos Pueblo, and it was mimeographed as an ethnological paper. And the Indians found out about it, the older men in the 30s. And every person that she talked to was brought up before the council, and they were fined or whipped. So I was afraid that would happen to all my friends. Mm-hmm. So I happened to be in California at the time I received the first advance copy of the book. So I sent it back to the town council, the interpreter, and requested him to show it to the council and to read passages. And if there was any objections, to wire me, and I would come right back before the council. Mm-hmm. So as a result, I'd never have had any
repercussions at all.
Repercussions. Yeah.
And therefore, no one's talked to you about it either.
No, I've had people a few years since, they come up and tell me, gee, you told us a lot of very fine things, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That is, younger people now that have grown up and haven't had the advantages of Kiva training, because they've been GIs and been away, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they appreciate me, which I like, you see.
Yeah.
Because these older people will die out and it'll all die out, but this is... Mm-hmm. This is on record for him.
Yeah. Do you actually look forward to the Pueblo disappearing within 100 years or so? It seems strange because it has been there for, quite a few centuries now.
Oh, it's probably from 1200.
Yeah. Will it survive the kind of progress that we see going on now?
I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
The land is owned communally. It's not owned by families with a fee simple title, so they can never mortgage it or sell it. It owns by all. But what will happen when the old people die off and the young people will want to get out in the white world? That will be the problem.
Yeah.
I think it ought to be preserved together with all the old Pueblos as a wonderful example of prehistoric life and architecture in this country.
Yes. We mentioned the kind of practical problem earlier that comes in here too. Maria, again in People of the Valley, thinks or says something toward the end of the novel about fulfillment rather than progress,
yes.
which is a nice distinction.
Yes.
But now, do you see any hope of this carrying over to the white race in the West?
I think the values will carry over, maybe not in the same medium, the ceremonies themselves will be given up, but the meanings and values, I hope, will be carried mm-hmm. over.
But they'll almost have to seep out into the context, won't they, rather than be maintained
yes.
at the Pueblo?
Yes, I think so.
Mm-hmm. Well, could you give just one instance of how this might work? You know, when you talk about values, you're on slippery ground. What is a value? How is it preserved? Do you think of one thing from the values within the Pueblo that ought to be maintained outside the Pueblo when the time comes?
Well, this would be getting into it, but for example, Jung, C.G. Jung, the great mm-hmm. psychologist, visited Taos Pueblo many years ago before he died, and he picked up several myths, and he found that these were archetypal myths that he could find in his own ill patients and some of the designs mm-hmm. in the sand paintings mm-hmm. were these mandala shaped archetypal designs. So this is just the same old myth common to all humanity that's expressed in an Indian medium
mm-hmm.
so this will still apply.
Yeah. You think now that this is confined to the West, these concerns. I've said on occasion that I think Eastern fiction is pretty much influenced by Freud, and that Western has certain affinities to Jung's theories.
Yes.
Would you agree with that?
Oh, yes, certainly. I think Freud's out of fashion. He was the great innovator. He was the pioneer. But psychology has gone far beyond Jung. And I mean far beyond Freud, mm-hmm. and I think Jung gets into a deeper level. Mm-hmm. And I think this will last quite mm-hmm. a while. And apparently the same thing would hold true with certain African tribes. It's a basic thing.
Mm-hmm. Now yet, we're not going to be one bit willing to go back to primitive living conditions.
Oh, no, no. No, but the inherent meaning of...
Yeah, the problem is to separate, really, progress from fulfillment somehow.
But to carry over the values into modern living, that's the point.
Yeah. Now again, although we agree that fiction shouldn't primarily get at teaching of this sort. Do you see anything out of The Man Who Killed the Deer or People of the Valley which, you know, in literature would make this kind of contribution to...
Well, all I know is that you can't put these things into word in fiction because you preach. Mm-hmm. You're no longer telling a story. In The Man Who Killed the Deer, I tried to do that simply because you have to put it in a printed word, the mm-hmm. things that aren't spoken, and I simply put them in italics.
Mm-hmm.
Because Indians don't talk like this.
No.
They don't put it into any language. So I just put it into italics mm-hmm. to separate it from the storytelling context of the novel,
mm-hmm.
but still give the emotional value,
yeah.
which was my way of solving a technical problem.
Mm-hmm. This makes The Man Who Killed the Deer a little different from People of the Valley, which
yes.
is completely an imagistic novel.
That's right.
And allows the whatever information or values there are to come out of the images.
Well, these Spanish people were down-to-earth people, primitive down-to-earth people. Whereas the Indians have this ceremonial or mystical overtone
mm-hmm.
to their life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's difficult to get.
Yeah. You mean difficult to get as an artist presenting the images
yes.
to make the
That's right.
the Anglo reader
yes.
understand.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Right.
For the past half hour, you've joined author Frank Waters and his host at the University of South Dakota, Dr. John Milton, chairman of the Department of English, in another in the series, Who Reads the Mountains? Directed by Ernest Phelps. This program was videotaped at KUSD-TV, the University of South Dakota, Vermilion. This is David Dale.